It's this one. And it will take over the world by getting smaller. Ted Hoff is the guy who dreamed up the microprocessor. In the spring of 1970, when they began the design of the chip, none of his team thinks of themselves as revolutionaries.
Essentially, we did take the computer out of its ivory tower, out of its walled-in, glassed-in, air-conditioned cage, and we put it, you might say, everywhere. Nothing's gonna
change my world. The microchip did change our world, and more than any rally held here in Central Park, or any revolutionary song sung by the Beatles. The Beatles, in fact, were not revolutionaries, they were rebels. And as such, finally, they were unable to agree even with themselves. In the spring of 1970, the Beatles broke up. The music stopped. And a generation that claimed to believe in radical change was suddenly faced with its own kind of future shock. The very music that had seemed to score an entire political and cultural movement in this country had stopped. And as somebody back then said, once the singing stops, the revolution's over.
When I find myself in times of trouble, Mother Mary comes to me, speaking words of wisdom, let it be.
When the game changed to a money game instead of a music game, it was a new game, and it got nasty. It was just like your classic business maneuvers and everything. And lots of things went down. I think everyone sort of hurt each other sufficiently to just say, well, sod it all, we're going to break up, you know.
Let it be, let it be. Whisper words of wisdom, let it be.
Come back to the spring of 1970, when a pound of Long Island potatoes cost 9 cents. And when all that millions of Americans wanted was to breathe clean air and drink a good glass of water. Welcome back to the spring of 1970, a season of revolutionary ideas. The same March issue of Playboy that gave us Alvin Toffler's shocking look at the future gave us a feature article on revolution and counter-revolution. And on the cover, the publisher's girlfriend. Nothing revolutionary about that. But revolutionary symbols were all around us that spring. Counter-revolutionary symbols, too. Maybe clothes didn't make the man or woman, but they sure let you know where they stood.
Still, clothes weren't ideas, and it was ideas that challenged the establishment. Supreme Court Justice William O. Douglas wrote a book, Points of Rebellion, in which he said that young people were absolutely right to rise up against poverty, injustice, poor education, and pollution. He said dissent was an American right, and Douglas pointed out that violence was not protected by the Constitution, but that protest often boiled over into violence because people were emotional, not rational. He was right. In the spring of 1970, the pot boiled over.
Three members of the Weatherman Underground are killed when a bomb they were building explodes in a New York City townhouse. In April, the survivors polish up their rhetoric and declare war on the United States.
This is Bernadine Dorn. I'm going to read a declaration of a state of war. This is the first communication from the Weatherman Underground. Protests and marches don't do it. Revolutionary violence is the only way.
For a couple of freelancers in Madison, Wisconsin, the war has begun. Carl Armstrong and his brother have bombed an ordnance plant from a plane. Carl has bombed an ROTC building. And in the spring, he tries to blow up a dam.
We made a lot of mistakes. We were scared stiff all the time. I mean, we were really paranoid. And it was the firebombing of the ROTC building on campus was the first illegal thing I had done in my whole life. I was scared. Everyone was scared, and, it wasn't an easy thing to do.
Led by the FBI, city and state police strike back all across the country. They see the damage done by a few real revolutionaries and conclude that the American way of life is in jeopardy. And they jeopardize it further by launching the broadest program of domestic spying and infiltration that this country has ever seen. John Ehrlichman was the president's advisor on domestic policy.
It's hard to say whether what the FBI did, for instance, was an overreaction. When you were there and these reports were coming in, people being killed, injured, laboratories being blown up, that kind of thing, I think everybody felt that there was an obligation to do something. Now, the methods that were used to try and find out who did it were eventually held to be illegal, unconstitutional. We didn't know that at the time.
Those methods are aimed at women's groups, gays, American Indians, almost any organization that advocates social change, and there are lots of them.
Because the American protesters are holding out the last hope.
Another voice advocating change in Chicago belongs to young Jesse Jackson. His cause is Operation Breadbasket. On his first day at the police academy, Howard Pointer is recruited to spy on Jackson.
They informed me that they wanted me to work for the intelligence division, subversive unit, which was known as the Red Squad. In the spring of 1970, I was sent to Operation Breadbasket, and I was told to become vocal and so that I could move up within the organization and therefore gain or gather more information for the police department.
Well, then believe it, my friend, that the silence can end. We'll just have to get guns and be men.
The most feared group is the Black Panthers. On the one hand, the Panthers are a political and social organization. They provide breakfast for inner-city school children. Yes, but they also carry guns and vow to use them in self-defense. By the spring of 1970, four policemen and 28 Panthers have been killed. Bobby Seale, chairman and co-founder of the Black Panther Party.
All we did was picked up guns and said, we're going to organize our people, and we're going to exercise our democratic right to do so. But if you shoot at us, we're shooting back.
Their meetings were probably the most frightening of all of the meetings that I attended, because they would say, we know you pigs out there, you know, in the audience, and we know that you've come here to spy on us, and we're going to kill you, you know. So everyone in the audience would look at each other, you know, they would, you know, become paranoid, start looking all around, say, who is it, you know, is it you? And I would sit there and look kind of mean, you know, it's not me, I'm not doing it, you know, it must be this guy behind me, you know.
Free Bobby Seale! Free Bobby Seale!
Spies were not tolerated. Bobby Seale was on trial for killing an alleged police informant. But still, many people thought Seale had been framed. There were Free Bobby rallies. If he were convicted, said the Panthers, they were prepared to start a war, a civil war.
The Black Panther Party throughout this nation had armed themselves while I was on trial and said if they convicted me, it was the word was out that there would be no lights for days.
Childhood, we are told, decides. And so it is that Sesame Street tries to show black and white children living in harmony. It is meant to be a song for the future, a better future. But in May 1970, the state of Mississippi refuses to broadcast Sesame Street. It has too many black people on it.
Well, Sesame Street survived, and so did the kids, uncorrupted even in Mississippi, where the program was soon restored. Kids are not incorruptible, certainly. But when they encounter corruption, they're more likely to resist than succumb. When they see the corruption of the earth, the pollution of their environment, they're more likely to wonder why than make excuses for it. And in April of 1970, when adults proclaimed Earth Day and declared war against pollution, kids didn't wait to get drafted, they enlisted. 10 million school children made some kind of public statement that day.